Welcome everybody to the Chamber of Commerce. How many of you have been here before? Good, most of you. So I'm just going to deliver some brief introductory remarks and also about our guest speakers. So good afternoon, as I said. Today we're going to take a closer look at, we're going to take a closer look at the procurement law and how it will affect your business. Has changes not only will affect the government, but also will affect the way the supplier community interacts with government for procurement projects. The changes have been approved by Cabinet, as many of you know, and they're set to take effect on the 1st of May. So leading today's session is Craig Milley. He's the first ever director of procurement for the Cayman Islands government. He was appointed to the position in February 2015. Previously, he served as the head of procurement for a mid-sized city in Canada, which will remain nameless, I guess, for nearly a decade, where he oversaw $150 million in annual spend. He holds a bachelor's degree with a double major in political science and history and a minor in business administration. He has served as the vice president of the Canadian Public Procurement Council, which represents over 100 public agencies from all levels of government across Canada. He is joined by Peter Goff and Elizabeth Jerry. Elizabeth is the Deputy Director of the Central Procurement Office of the Cayman Islands Government, and she assists in the development of government-wide policies and training programs, and she has a strong blend of procurement and project management expertise, which she's gained over 30 years of experience in the field of supply chain management, and she holds 4 procurement-specific designations, which she's going to have to tell you more about. She has worked on procurements in an extensive range of goods and services, including P3S. Is that a secret code? Okay, P3S. Then we have Mr. Peter Goff, who is coming out of his third retirement. He's worked over 40 years in the public service. Wow. Congratulations, Peter. He's primarily managed organizations and developed and implemented policies for human resources, financial management, and good governance. Over the last 27 years of his career, he spent in the Caribbean developing and implementing public sector reform strategies. I've worked with Peter on several of those, and he's a hard worker and a difficult taskmaster. He has developed police and written laws for the criminal justice system. He's recently been involved in implementing constitutions, including the Bill of Rights in Cayman and Montserrat, which included the training of 6,000 public servants. His work as a strategic advisor to the Deputy Governor included the development of the Conditional Release Law, the Public Authorities Law, and the Procurement Law. So today's session, as I said to some of you earlier, is being recorded and streamed live, and you'll be able to access the videos at a later time if necessary. So, with those few brief introductory remarks, please welcome Mr. Milley.
Well, thanks everyone. It's great to be back at the Chamber, and great to have you guys here in person, and anybody watching, welcome. We're glad to be back. Peter and I were trying to figure out when we were last here, because this has been a bit of a labor of love, emphasis on the labor, maybe less so on the love, since late 2015. So we were here, we pitched some of the proposed changes that are now coming into effect. So we're here to really guide you through what's going to happen. We've got a new law and regulations coming into effect on May 1st, which is going to significantly change how we do procurement. It's going to affect civil servants, public servants, as well as suppliers, and we hope the broader community as well. So we'll take you through a presentation here. I'm going to be handing over shortly to Peter and to Liz, and they're going to walk you through some of the changes. And then towards the end, I'm going to come back and I get to do some fun stuff. We have a brand new website, and I'll plug this at the beginning and I'll plug it several times later, but procure.gov.ky. That's going to be our mantra for the next few months. And it's an exciting new website that was developed here locally, and we want to show you. It's got a lot of resources, a lot of information relating to things you'll hear today. For the folks that have handouts here in the audience, don't worry. Anything we're handing out here is also available on the website, including this presentation as well. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to my esteemed colleague, Peter, and we'll get started.
Good afternoon,
everyone.
This initiative is all part of the government's striving for good governance over the last 20-odd years. And we've passed numbers of pieces of legislation which contribute to good governance. We've passed the public finance law, we've passed the public service management law, which deals with our government deals with HR. We passed the public authorities law, which I know Tim helped us with in terms of good governance for statutory authorities and government companies. And there's been a number of other pieces of legislation and standards in public life. We've just now introduced a new agency of government called the Ombudsman, which will deal with whistleblowing, it will deal with FOA complaints, it will deal also with complaints against the police. So all these initiatives are part of good governance. Good governance means different things to different people, but to me, it's everything that government does is about good governance and how we can improve the lives or enrich the lives of the citizens we serve. The procurement changes are quite fundamental, and they affect a number of agencies, as well as government agencies, but also suppliers of goods and services. But it also, I believe, the new procurement regime actually shines a light on government activity. And one of the underpinning principles that Craig and I developed was if you can open up government in terms of transparency, that the public, the supplier community are our best auditors. So when we go through a number of these slides we'll go through, we will focus on how it's going to affect suppliers of government services. But it's important that you also know who are the players in the procurement regime, what role the government plays in terms of the cabinet, what role the chief officer plays, what role the actual procurement office plays. Because one thing that government has a problem with is role clarity. And we have a lot of overlapping responsibilities, and sometimes that's difficult because you can't hold people to account if your roles are not clearly specified. So I want to start off by defining what procurement is. I mean, many people, we think of procurement as purchasing, yeah? Or we talk about procurement being buying goods and services. And we think that because we do that in our personal lives, that we're good at it. We don't have to account for how we spend our money in our personal lives. And I tell the story about when my wife was 6 months pregnant, about looking to buy a sports car, a two-seater sports car. Now, that wasn't fit for purpose. Also, I didn't do a proper business case, right? But it's similar. Although I don't have to account for anyone apart from my wife, we have to account for all the money we spend because it's not public money, it's taxpayers' money. Although we say we don't pay tax, we do in many different ways. So the whole definition of procurement is not just actually buying stuff, it's also about doing a proper business case to make sure that we're buying it for the right reasons, that we're actually buying it at the right price, and that procurement extends past just the purchasing. It extends through to servicing the agreement and to the end of the useful life of the asset. So procurement is much wider than purchasing. And as you see, if you go through this presentation, we talk a lot about the proper business case. And you, from a private sector environment, know everything about business cases. You're not going to invest in anything unless you're going to get a return. Now, this is not a new concept, but it's a concept which is, over the last 10 years, has come through into the parlance of government. But the case has to be made if you're going to spend money. Okay. So, procurement is a core function of government. And we spend 20%, 7%, nearly a third of all government expenditure goes on supplies and services. And approximately 50% on personnel. We have in government a number of HR specialists, both at the ministry level, at the departmental level, at statutory authority level, and the government company level. We have a lot of personnel experts that are well qualified in HR. But when we look at procurement, we don't have any expertise, present company executive. Yeah? Because it's not considered a profession in government, because we all think we can buy stuff. So what we're trying to do not only is set some rules and regulations around procurement, we want to enhance the career prospects of young Canadians, that this is a proper career, and to train. We're going through a series of training programs to get people up to speed. We've got 10, I think, sessions in the next month. But we also want to encourage young Canadians to take this on as a profession, because it is a profession. So, as the procurement law was really came about because our Auditor General did some very critical reports of our procurement. And when he wrote these reports, before I get on to that, there is no law at the moment to cover procurement. It's all done through regulation. When the Auditor General did his reports, these were some of the things which, and I haven't got more here, but these are, it doesn't show, does it? Okay. Value for money, not realised. A lot of criticism of government spending money, not getting what they set out to get for their dollar. Lack of transparency. A lot of criticism of government letting contracts and people tendering and not knowing whether they got the contract or not, not being told. And where there's no transparency, there's going to be suspicion. Suspicion that contracts going to be left to friends, colleagues. So a lack of transparency is one thing the Auditor General felt was an important one. We covered the no procurement expertise. Political interference was also something which the Auditor General highlighted. That. And I use the word political interference, probably not the best term to use, but there were claims that certain individuals that were in a position, were in a political position, were influencing what suppliers to go to. And we had, obviously, the high profile case recently of Kerpe, where here is a board member of a statutory authority, the HSA, actually making decisions about procurement. There was suspicion that there was fraud, there was suspicion there was corruption in a number of the contracts that were being let. There was also a lack of corporate information of what we were actually buying. We didn't know as an agency what we were actually buying, because every department and every section went to Kirk office or office supply with their bag and picked up a few pens here, some pads and some staples or whatever. So they went to a government. The government didn't get any benefit from any sort of bulk purchasing. So if I went to Kirk to buy a pen, a standard pen, I would pay $3.50. We were buying thousands and thousands of pens, and we were still paying $3.50. But everybody was buying their own thing. So there was no corporate information about what we were buying. So we weren't throwing any leverage on the fact that we were buying lots of stuff, but we were buying it in little small increments. So, I say, as a private individual, I was paying the same price as government was paying for a pen. There was no policy, as the second bullet point on the right, there are no policy for local business development. There used to be back in the early 90s, there was a financials and storage regulation where there was some policy whereby if it was, I think, 10%, you may remember this well, if it was 10% more expensive to go locally than to go overseas, you bought locally. But at the moment, there is no policy on how we can develop local businesses in terms of whether a balancing value for money against the of helping the local economy. Because I'm sure the government could buy all its stationery overseas, right, all its pens and papers and what have you, but then we wouldn't be stimulating the local economy. So that was one thing that the Auditor General thought, that government ought to have a policy about whether to buy locally or to buy overseas, and how to balance that decision. There was no code of conduct for persons involved in procurement, both from a public servant point of view, but also for suppliers. Okay, so what we have done, and we'll be discussing this a little bit later, so we have a draft code of conduct, we'd like some input on that, from not only from the civil service, because if a civil servant or public servant breaks the code of conduct for procurement, we can easily discipline. But if a supplier breaks that code of conduct, in terms of maybe putting undue pressure, or offering gifts or bribes to go to that particular supplier, then we don't have any sanction. But now we have a code of conduct in draft where we will have sanctions against a supplier that illegally influences the results of a tender. We also observed from the reports that the Auditor General put together that there was only one procurement method, which meant open tendering. Everybody thought that open tendering was the best method of getting value for money, and we proved that it wasn't. And we have now experimented with another method of tendering called reverse auctions. Some of you may have heard of that expression. It's a bit like a reverse eBay. And we've done a number of these for office supplies, computer equipment for the whole of government, and the most startling one was the medical supplies and pharmaceuticals. And a reverse auction basically says that a supplier can put in all the bid documents without the price, right? And then we start electronic auction. And that auction can last for an hour, because it closes down 3 minutes after the last bid is put in, okay? Or in the case of the medical supplies and pharmaceuticals, it went on for 5 days because each supplier was trying to beat each other. They didn't know who they're bidding against. It was just bidder 1, 2, 3, and 4. So a bidder would put in a bid thinking they were going to get it because they were first, and then somebody would beat that bid and they would go from the first down to second or third. So on a budget of 12 million, which we spend on pharmaceuticals and medical supplies, we saved $4 million on that, just on that process alone. And what was really striking was one drug which we buy is an antiviral for treatment of HIV. We were paying $30 a tablet for that particular drug. After the auction, the same drug we were buying for $1.30. So our drug budget for antivirals came down from a third of a million down to $3,000. So the person we have, a person, an expert on this, and Greg introduced us to this method, which has saved the government and will continue to save government money. So I said, well, why do drugs cost so high in the US? If we can get it at $1.30, are they still paying $30 in the US? I said, oh yes, because President Bush made it illegal to negotiate with drug companies for price. So we're getting a better deal on drug prices than we are in the US. So that was a good example of opening up the procurement methods to make it much more value for money, to be much more competitive. And we save lots of money on office supplies and on computer equipment. And both the office supplies and the computer equipment were bid by local firms. not bidding against overseas firms. So we can restrict it depending on the marketplace. So having looked at all that, that the Auditor General, these are the things that we tried to address when we wrote the law and regulations. So I started this in 2012, producing a report. And this report was endorsed by the States of Jersey. States of Jersey are renowned for their acuteness in procurement. So they asked them if they would look at our report to see if it had if it was a good report, if it was about best practice. And it's just this example shows how good procurement can reduce costs. They sent two consultants over from the States of Jersey. And I said, well, how much are you going to charge us, consultants coming over? No, we won't charge you anything. We are state employees. Yeah, but you must, you know, pay your airfare and your hotel and all your per diems. I'm sure we should pay something. He said, no. We have central procurement. And every, Cayman, the States of Jersey is an island, they travel a lot. So all the air miles that government officials travel goes into a corporate pot. Doesn't go into individual miles for individuals, okay. So they were able to fund the whole thing by the corporate air miles. That's a really good example of how procurement can save money. So then the deputy governor was given the task of actually improving our procurement. So I was given the task to chair the working group. The first thing the cabinet did, and realized when the report was done, that they couldn't do this without proper expertise. And then they set up the Central Procurement Office and recruited Craig and Elizabeth, and a third person is to be added this year. And you know, if Craig was paid on the American money, he'd save the government on a percentage you could retire for the rest of your life. Millions, I'm sure you'd save them, absolutely millions. We established, as I said before, and many of you know, the Central Tenders Committee was the committee that recommended contracts within the public sector, and they were made up of private individuals as well as government. And these were the principles that they were using on procurement, which we've adopted, so we haven't changed anything. The CTC, although it's going to be renamed the Public Procurement Committee, essentially will do the same task. Right, this hand over one.
Peter and I are going to jump in and out a little bit. But certainly those principles, I'm hoping that you will find through the changes, through the procurement law and the introduction of a lot of new procedures and policies, that those are all going to be strengthened. But with anything, there's exceptions to the new law, and this is really very much in line with what exceptions would be in other countries. So procurement between entities, emergency situations, contracting for employment, it might be disposition of land or acquisition of art, subscriptions, regulated utilities. These are all things that would be exempt. And Peter, did you want to roll the cabinet?
Talked about good governance, it's important to know, for people to know what role they play. And Cabinet really has no role to play in procurement. Their only role is to establish a policy that promotes the economic and social objectives of the country. They're not involved. Nor are board members, who are obviously basically chosen by politicians. So board members and civil MLAs are not involved in the procurement exercise. Okay, try and take the political part out. But they do have, particularly board members, have a role, right? They are the ones that set the budget, agree the business case. And it's the chief executive or the chief officer that makes the final decision. Now, when I've done a presentation to boards, they say, well, if we don't make the decision, what are we here for? Well, you're here to make sure that the budget's available and that the business case is sound. We do not want either politicians or programs to actually make the plain decision. Okay? And that's to protect both sides of things. You know. Cabinet has a minor role in terms of the procurement aspect, but a very important role in making sure that the procurement policy actually encourages the economy and expands employment in the environment.
So Craig and I in the Central Procurement Office, we report into the Ministry of Finance and the Financial Secretary. They're responsible for providing us resources and providing oversight of the Central Procurement Office. They're also there to ensure that that the government is getting value for money in the centralized procurement function. So what is the role of the Central Procurement Office? Developing the regulations, policies, and procedures, and that's why you're here today to hear some of the changes that are in effect as of May 1st. Training and guiding all public officials, that's a big task because we estimate that there's probably 500 people who touch procurement in the government. We're ensuring that the laws and policies and procedures are all accessible, and you're going to hear more about our website, www.procure.gov.ky, as our shameless plug. So this is all going to be there for you to view. We're also implementing a code of conduct, which Peter has mentioned, and we're going to show that to you in a short bit. This code of conduct is up on our website right now as a draft, and it's there for your feedback and for your viewing. A big role, of course, is advising chief officers on major projects. Establishing public reporting of solicitations and awards. This is one of the big new changes for May 1st. So it's going to be a one-stop portal on our website that you will be able to see all this information. Training and education and moments like today, and we're doing this about 15 more times for government employees. Establishing government-wide contracts for commonly used goods and services. So we've already done this with office supplies, and there's a number of other goods and services that are in the works with savings by amalgamation of product. Introducing e-procurement tools to replace the manual procurement processes, and this is a benefit to both government, that they can do things faster, more efficiently, but also to the supplier community that can actually submit bids online. And for us in government, we've saved about 200,000 sheets of paper so far, so hopefully suppliers are also realizing that benefit.
The one thing that we wanted to make sure when we did this legislation that we didn't undermine accountability of the chief officer, which for the chief executive of a statutory authority. So the role of the chief officer or the chief executive is to make sure these things, that there's a proper business case, there's a reason why you're going to go out by yourself, that the funding's there, they will be awarding the contracts, not the committee, not the public procurement committee or the entity procurement committee. If the awarding of a contract will be the chief officer's responsibility. And it's also his responsibility 30 days after the contract is signed to put it on the website. So everybody will know exactly who got the contract and how much the contract was worth. Okay? This is very important that we make this whole procurement process transparent so that everybody knows. It will also have opportunity for suppliers who are unsuccessful in bidding for government work. It will give them an opportunity to be debriefed. Okay? What that means, it doesn't mean that, what it does mean is you get an opportunity as an unsuccessful bidder to know why you didn't get the contract. Okay? This is not a time when you're there to renegotiate and bring your prices down, but it's important that the bidder knows why they were unsuccessful. It may improve the quality of the bid next time for them, or they understand a bit better of what's required. So every unsuccessful bidder can ask for an interview for be debriefed. Now, these committees, the Public Procurement Committee, the old CTC, and the Entity Procurement Committee, can make an assessment and they can make a recommendation, but the Chief Officer or the Chief Executive Officer is the one that makes the decision to award the contract. They don't have to stick with the recommendation of the committee, but if they don't stick with it, then they have to inform the director of the reasons, which is very okay. But the good thing is they've got to put that on the website, why they didn't accept the reasons, the recommendations. So it's completely transparent. Okay? So, not saying it would happen, but if a chief officer thought they wanted to give a contract to someone who, I don't know, was connected in some way, then they would have to give the reasons why they departed from the recommendation of the committee.
Just in the instance that they don't put a contract on the website or they don't advise the reasons, are there repercussions somehow in the regulations for those civil servants?
Because
what we've seen many times is there's no repercussions.
Right. There's a code of conduct for civil servants, and they are mandated to put all procurement processes in New York, and we'll show you the page on the website, that they have to put it on. If they don't put it on, they are then contributing the code of conduct, and that could, if it's a gross misconduct, could lead to dismissal. So I think the transparency aspect of this is to benefit to all. It keeps everybody on the straight and narrow. The suppliers know what's happening. Civil servants can't do things which may cause issues in the future. So there would be consequences, yes. Because before we didn't have a law, you see. Now they would be breaking the law if we didn't comply with the law regulations. So there could be sanctions, and there probably would be sanctions. So the Public Procurement Committee, the old CTC, they will not change that much, but the actual appointment of the Public Procurement Committee will be made by the governor. Okay, they will not be. In the past, it was a political decision who went on the committee. Now it's the governor's decision. Yes, she will, or he now, will appoint the chair and three members, and that they can't be public servants, but they will be recommended by the premier. And the leader of the opposition, again, gets one member, and the deputy governor appoints recommends three civil service members. With all of those, whether it is to this committee or to the Entity Public Committee, we have to make sure that committee members have the right skills to be able to deal with, and the right experience and knowledge to be able to deal with it. Whether it be legal, financial, procurement expertise, but more importantly, they have to have integrity and have to be as politically neutral as possible when you've been recommended by a politician. And they should have no financial or other interests that could prejudice their fairness and to exercise their function. So Liz will explain the Entity Procurement Committee. These are internal committees of government.
Yeah, so the Entity Procurement Committee acts similarly to what Peter has just described with the Public Procurement Committee. It's made up of a chairman and two persons. The committee members have to have that requisite skill set of the procurement, legal, and financial background. And again, there's public reporting of awards and report of annual procurement activities. To go back to the previous question, that's an additional oversight. These are just thresholds, and I'm going to point out your handout today, and of course we have this on our website for anyone who's not present, but this is highlighting the different changes that are occurring as of May 1st. So everything in blue on your pages there are things that have changed, and things that that haven't been colored yet are actually status quo. So you'll find that there have been quite a number of small tweaks. So the Public Procurement Committee is going to have that external oversight. It's thresholds of 250,000 and up. There is a business case that Peter had talked about that is now a requirement, and solicitation documents have to match that, which was presented in the business case. They will also receive bids and ensure that fairness, impartiality, and confidentiality. The Entity Procurement Committee is going to operate the same way, with those people reviewing the business case and solicitation documents, and this is at thresholds of 100 to 250, and again, ensuring that fairness, impartiality, and confidentiality. So procurement valuation is an important concept. We want prior to the start of the procurement, so at the initial stages, that the valuation of the procurement is inclusive of all costs. So it will include the delivery, installation, training, maintenance. We did a purchase of business machines recently, and that included consumable products that went into the purchase, it went into warranty, it went into the maintenance costs. And we had this question at another session that we had, what happens about splitting contracts to avoid a threshold, and clearly that's not going to be permissible. The code of conduct that we discussed, and Craig is going to show it to us on the website when he gets a moment. This is addressing the conflict of interest. It's governing the conduct, as Peter mentioned, of both public officials, but also the supplier community, and a breach being grounds for disciplinary action if it's on the part of a public official, and potential preclusion of future bidding opportunities on behalf of the supplier. The business case requirement is that it's now going to be a fully argued costed risk and impact assessment, and it's taking into consideration the broader socioeconomic impact. So there is going to be options that will be reviewed at this stage to promote positive economic development of the Kingman Islands. At the end of the day, the important thing is that an informed decision can be made as to whether a procurement actually proceeds. Thresholds again, under 100,000, not required. 100 to 250 is required by the ministry. 250 or greater, it's not only the business case, but here we get into local impact assessment, which we'll show you on the website shortly. 10 million and plus, it's all of those things, plus a formal industry consultation. Competition is always a preferred method, but there will be cases where a direct award process is going to be applicable. This is where you're going into awarding a contract to a pre-identified supplier, and these cases have to be documented, justified, and there will be parameters around when that can be used. Also, it has to be approved by the appropriate committee. monthly based on the threshold.
And it has to be publicly reported. So if it just goes through, if Chief Officer is going to go for that supplier, without going through a competitive process, he has to place it on the website and the reasons for it.
These are some of the times that you might use a direct award process. Value is under 10,000. It's one of a kind good. It's compatible with existing brand of equipment. It might be a replacement part. Could be of a unique design, maybe in the public interest, safety, security. It could be construction materials only available from one source. So the Cayman Islands Economic Development Preference, this is that taking into account the broader socioeconomic benefits. And how is that going to be done? Well, those impact assessments that are part of the business plan. Soliciting bids where there is adequate supply. Informing the local supplier community of upcoming procurement projects, and we expect in the future to be able to showcase that on our website where departments would be able to identify what it is that they're going to be buying based on where they've received their budget, and they might be able to show what quarter that they're going to be doing the procurement in. So it gives you a little bit of advanced planning. So we want maximum opportunity, and we want to avoid restriction in developing specifications. So that local impact assessment is at 250 or greater, and that formal local industry consultation is at 10 million and up. This impact statement is to show that positive impact on the community, and the idea is that it would be published and the suppliers would be held accountable to it. Evaluation criteria may take into account this impact on the local economy, and so there might be ratings that could be used. One of the bigger changes now is this public notice of opportunity and also the award. It's the one-stop shop, the portal with the central procurement office. This is the public advertisement. There can be supplemental advertisements as well in the local paper. If it's under 100,000, it can still be used on that same portal, and many departments are using it already. The solicitations now will be required to be open for a minimum of 15 days, and that would be business days, not calendar days. Competitive procurement methods, just to say that that they've increased from a tendering situation to all tendering requests for proposals that are with and without negotiation, with dialogue, without dialogue. And the electronic reverse auction that Peter introduced and Craig will speak to. Pre-qualifications can still take place. This is over 250,000, has to be part of the business case. And it can result in two ways. One is a list of pre-qualified suppliers that go on to a secondary process, or it might just be a framework agreement on the those as and when needed basis. Market research methods still. We have requests for information, requests for expression of interest, and that is really designed as a gathering of information to help inform the future procurement. It's not resulting in any kind of a contract. It's beneficial for the supplier community because they get a little advance warning of a procurement, allows them to plan a little better, and it allows government to obtain information to make sure those specifications are maybe generic and that the that any questions are raised. Specifications, as mentioned, this is where suppliers are making a decision as to whether they've got the capacity to bid, and they're going to make the effort to bid and spend the money to bid. So it's very important that specifications are drawn up correctly and expansive. They may describe physical characteristics. If it's service requirements, it might be deliverables and tasks that the service company would need to provide. Procurement documentation, that's really an internal thing to government, but we will be expecting that every file will be documented, complete with all the solicitation documents, but also the evaluation, the scoring, and all of that to be kept in a secure location. Acceptance of bids, for your information, I guess, under 100,000 is the approval of the head of the department and the chief officer. At 100 to 250, then the entity procurement committee is involved and will provide advice that the chief officer is to take, preferably. And 250 or more, that is on the advice of the PPC. Debriefing bidders, this is an opportunity at the end of the procurement process. Say you're unsuccessful, this is a chance to come in and discuss where you maybe lost points relative to the evaluation criteria that were part of the solicitation document to begin with. So it's not a comparison between suppliers, but it's a comparison back to the actual solicitation document. We think of this as a two-way street as well. We want to get the feedback as well from you. How could we do things better the next go-round? And the publication of contract award, this is the information that's going to be on that one-stop site that we keep mentioning. It's going to at least have who was awarded the contract, what the value was, what the date of the award was, and a description and for which ministry or entity. This is to be done within 30 days, and under 10,000 is going to be reported once a year. So we would like to show you the website, and if anyone has any questions.
Any questions, we'd be happy to take it at this time. Mm-hmm.
Question.
Yes.
Earlier you mentioned in terms of the bidding process, the reverse auction.
Yeah.
Is that for particular products? And how is that called? Because looking at the drugs, as you mentioned, the pharmaceutical side of it, I'm going in bidding. Am I bidding on a generic or the aftermarket drugs that I could come in at the dollar? How do we safeguard against that?
Yeah, and that's a good, excellent question, by the way. The first part is, and this applies to any procurement method. There's not one procurement method that's good for everything. So one size fits all. So there is no intent, and it probably wouldn't work anyway to do reverse auction on everything. What we view it as a strategic tool. It's one of many tools we have. So what we constantly are doing internally is looking through various commodities, various services to see if it's the right candidate for a reverse auction. Won't work in every case. There are many things where it's not easy for us to specify. So it goes back to that slide Liz talked about specifications. If we can specify something so we have a good comparator, apples to apples, then go through a fairly intensive process internally. Just to give you some big numbers, places that have done this for many years, City of Los Angeles, for example, they look at 1,200 contracts per quarter, of which they do 6 to 8 auctions per quarter. So it's a very small subset, but when you choose the right one, the potential is significant. So it's a very strategic tool. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, it
does. Did you ask about generic?
And that gets back to the specification. Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks, Peter. Because that's exactly when we do one of these, those kinds of issues are in the specification. So if we're open to generics, which we were in this case, mm-hmm. we wanted to see. We allowed bidders to bid on both generic and branded, and we had a number of different criteria in there, but that was certainly part of the consideration. At the end of the day, back to the pharmaceutical ones, the biggest decision in there isn't price necessarily, even though we drove price down and we had some significant savings. At the end of the day, the ultimate decision is by the care providers. Is this drug effective? Does it have efficacy? Does it meet the standard? Sometimes one of the things I learned is it's difficult to move patients off of a drug that's working really well to something that, and the patient is stable. You may not want to move, irrespective of what the price of the drug is, you may not want to move that patient over to another drug. So those clinical types of decisions, we like to ensure that those decisions are part of the overall decision. So at the end of the day, we ended up saving $4 million. We actually could have saved more, if I'm being honest with you. But that was the clinical decision to say, you know, there's certain, some drugs we're not willing to use the term try out or experiment with. So they were, even though they were reputable suppliers, reputable products, it may not have worked for our patients. So that's the kind of analysis that does go into the process. But it does come back to that. Ultimately, the bid document and the specification that we did.
Craig, if I could just go through, because I'm trying to understand who's driving the bus. You have some new entities established under your new structure. So for example, I'll just use one simple example. All of government needs vehicles of some sort.
Yeah.
But Public Works may need vehicles now, but the Ministry of Transport may need them another time. Who makes the decision as to whether, you know, we consolidate all of our automobile purchasing, or do we? Is the bus driven by the ministry or the department as and when they need it?
Yeah, that's another good question. That's certainly part of our mandate in our office. We don't have, we've been given direction to look at those types of areas where there is the opportunity to consolidate and go out to market. And it's like what we did with office supplies. We're looking at computers, vehicles is another great area. The biggest issue is every entity has their budget. Unfortunately, the Senate Procurement Office doesn't have the budget. So we're in a role of facilitating that discussion. So we do have that actually ongoing as we speak. And we're aware of Ministry A is going out for this. We'll often be the intermediary that will go over to other potential players and see if we can bring that together. Short of a change in the budgeting process, I don't know that that will change significantly, but it certainly, with this new function, will be something for the office. I always say, Peter, the office was named before I got here, and it's called Central Procurement Office, which implies that we're doing the procurements. In fact, I tend to think of it as a strategic procurement office. Our goal is to try and bring together all of these different parts that sometimes are operating independently.
Additionally, Craig, if we do fund the office supplies, for example, once we've got the prices to where we agree with the supplier, any government entity could tap into that in a subsequent agreement. So they may not have been part of the initial budget, but when they could see prices we were getting, they could then tap into that. What do you call it?
A framework agreement. Yeah, call-offs, they call it.
Things that make call-offs, even though they weren't part of the initial bid.
And that's something we'll be doing more and more of that in the coming months and years. One of the, oh, sorry, yep, let's do ladies first.
Will the duties be waived for items that are coming in for government?
So will the duties be
waived?
Well, there is a policy right now, the Ministry of Finance, that says that anything intended for government consumption is duty-free. But there is a process that stuff has to go through. So all I can say is there's no change to the duty-free situation at this point in time. It is, yeah, ultimately the government.
Yeah, because every government is different.
Yeah.
Work permits, if you have to bring in a specialist to install equipment, do they have to get a work permit as well?
I'm not the expert in that. I wouldn't want to intrude into something
okay.
else. I do know. I certainly encourage you to seek out the folks at
okay.
immigration.
The other question I have is donations. Is there anywhere in this law that covers that?
Yeah, if I recall, Peter, we had a discussion way back when, and I think there is one of the direct award clauses in there is about philanthropic type purchases. I'll have to get back to you on that one for sure.
Yeah, I think there is. Yeah,
that's a good question.
Especially if it uses a lot of consumables, and they donate the equipment that's worth $5,000, and then they charge $100,000 in consumables.
Yeah, and in that scenario, we would treat that as a unsolicited proposal, which ultimately could be a sole source if we accepted that proposal. If a direct award, so under the new law, as of May 1st, it would have to comply with that list of justifications. But I can't remember that one specifically. But I'll go back and forth that for you.
Sorry. I think I have to. Well, one of your items was any contract, and including less than $10,000, has to be put on the website eventually. What defines a contract? Meaning a purchase order is a contract.
Yeah.
Legally, my business, we get from the government minimum 20 purchase orders a day.
Yeah.
So government then has to put a copy of those on the website within a year. And if that's the case, that seems like it's too voluminous and no one's going to care.
So let me just clarify. I don't think we implied that it was a copy of the contract or the purchase order. What we're suggesting to people is it's an itemized list of all of the smaller purchases under $10,000. So what you will probably see is an Excel spreadsheet.
So every ministry or department would then be producing an Excel spreadsheet of everything they purchased from every different supplier on a yearly basis?
Mm-hmm. That's if we're talking about below the threshold.
I'm talking about below the
$10,000.
Because that's the reason I'm asking is not the supplier has to do anything, but I'm wondering about the value to who gains value from that voluminous exercise.
That's a good point. It may be a case of going too far in terms of transparency. I can certainly tell you from the research we've done, it's commonly done in the United States at the state and local level. So you can go to, I think, City of Tucson. They'll actually have an interface on their website of all of the, they call it a check register. Same idea. Every purchase made under a certain threshold is listed there. Sometimes it goes off.
Yeah, no, I think you guys actually, a procurement office might actually gain from that information. Then you can put it together and say, look, now we can do some other savings we didn't know about.
Yeah.
But, okay. And then the other question.
Just to add to what Craig said, it's also important for everyone to know who's buying what from who.
Yeah.
Because if you're getting a lot of business for a particular supplier and there are other suppliers that are not getting that, they're all under 10,000, but in a year they could add up to $120,000-$150,000. So it's important if I'm always buying from my brother's company, the public should know about that. So I think it's important from a transparent, it may be bureaucratic and there may be issues with that, but I think it's important that if you're always buying from a particular supplier, even though it's 5,000 here and 10,000 there. If it's your brother, should you be able to buy from your brother? If there's other market, there's somebody else in the market.
Well, this is the question then, really, because presumably in a code of conduct, it would address buying from your brother. But if you're the chief officer, you may not necessarily know that these small contracts are going to possibly your brother even, or
no,
that person's
exactly.
brother.
Exactly.
Yeah, so I'm not saying it's bad, I'm just wondering.
But they will be told about it, because they'll be looking at it and like, he's always buying from his brother.
Yeah, this is what hopefully.
And what it gets to is there was a slide which may have seemed innocuous at the time when Liz was talking about procurement valuation. So this is something that comes up all the time, this whole issue of splitting. So if you take the valuation of the purchase order, $100 or $1,000, don't do it that day, it's with the number. What the new law says is actually the valuation is on the totality of that in a 1 year period. So you could expend dollar by dollar all year long, but you may find, look at the thresholds, you may all of a sudden be above $100,000, you may all of a sudden be above $200,000. True story, I won't tell tales on that, but this morning, this exact conversation took place. Particular entities purchasing something on a recurring basis. Take the totality for the year, it's $375,000. It's never been reported. It's never been formally bid. So this is what we're trying to, again, it may swing too far, but we'll correct. But certainly that's the intent of public reporting, as Peter said, is about shining a light on those types of things. Doesn't mean what they're doing is wrong. That's the way it's been done. But if you think about it from a public interest perspective, I think we really need to know that that amount of money is being spent. But every purchase order is just one little drop in the bucket.
The other one, if I may, if I got the name, public. Procurement committee, mm-hmm. It's eight people suggested by the premier and
yeah.
various other people. They are supposed to be experts in the procurement of cars, medicine, office supplies. How do they effectively have their mandate to effectively give a recommendation to the chief officer to
right.
approve?
Okay. The entity procurement committee, if it's over 250,000, right? They act as a technical committee, right? And so that committee will contain experts for that particular procurement. It won't be necessarily a standing committee. So if the education department, for example, if they're going to buy laptops for the schools, on their entity procurement committee, they'll have some computer services, which they also conned on. So you'll conned on those committees, the experts you need for that particular procurement. So there will be technical people involved on the entity procurement committee. The people at the public procurement are there more there to see fairness, that there's no poor conduct in the procurement process. They're more to be an oversight
of the process.
Of the process of the public oversight. That's why there's, apart from the three civil servants, there are members of civil society on there. So they will receive the technical evaluation report from the entity procurement committee, which is where the technical advisor will come. So it's two different committees. Okay.
These are all good questions.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I go back to my question about, I understand the whole process and what has led to it. And I know Peter's done a lot of work with this and a lot of other people. You've basically just told us that you're more strategic now than you are embracing the whole mission, which is how do we get best value for money for anything we purchase for government. You've left that in the chief officer's hands. You have this advisory committee, or this oversight committee. And so my question really is, whose responsibility is it within the government sphere to ensure that we are always getting value for money, and who, and how are the chief officers or anybody else rewarded for doing that?
There's the after-event process, which is, you all know, is audit, public opinion, and a critical media, right? So those are the after the event things. Prior to that is the responsibility of the deputy governor to ensure that each chief officer operates in a manner that has value for them as part of their performance criteria. But going back to Craig's point, and I think we're on a journey here, and maybe the journey will end up having the central procurement unit doing procurement at everything sales of over 50,000, and we will put all the expertise, your expertise, in that central body. Because it's very difficult for a civil servant that is not a procurement expert, but is asked to write an RFP, is asked to do a major procurement, which he may have no training in, and may only do once every 5 years. Mm-hmm. So we're on a journey here, and I know where you're coming from, and we've discussed this. Maybe we will actually move towards actually having a central procurement, or a center of excellence of procurement, that will actually do procurement over a certain level. The point you made is very valid, but we're on a journey here.
Sorry, before you move on, back to the point in terms of every entry or purchase order being entered, isn't that going to be onus on the procurement team in each ministry, government?
Yes, it is.
When you look at, for instance, so a system that requires the supply, so you have the bidding process, you've gotten the equipment in now, and the running supplies. For each purchase order for supply, that would also need to be inputted on the website?
Well, not each time, but there would be annually, the department would have to put that on the website.
Okay.
What they'd spend, and it comes back to the point you made about continually spending 10,000, 10,000, 10,000.
Okay.
Is to show, it's transparency, I think, is the real answer to ensuring that public procurement is done properly. It will be an extra function for that department, but we think it's worthwhile.
There may be an opportunity to procure the service, because to do the following, to do the annual reporting at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe IT companies here would want to bid on an opportunity to go to an entity and say, look, we will build the interface to take all your POs, because entities, have some system for accounts payable. You know what I mean? And take that data and then translate it into whatever format is going to be usable on this database. And that's a whole other procurement for that. And I think they could develop a whole industry around that.
That may be okay for departments that are not actually linked to the central financial system, because we have a very sophisticated Oracle-based system of purchasing. We have a purchasing module and a catch receivable and what have you. So I think it's only a matter really of programming.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just a matter of programming. And so within central government, sounds like you have a solution, and then in the statutory authorities, government companies that use a different computer system, it's a little project to get somebody to write whatever it is.
I think most cash payable systems would actually be able to run a report.
Pardon?
I think most cash payable systems would be able to run a report.
So you can just take it, so it's just a straight import then?
Yeah.
Because, we're concerned, I hear the concern about the burden, but if it's just a straight import of data, then it's not as bad, and it's safe. Necessary to get an IT company that can bid on that work and get it done.
Just something off the beaten track, back up a bit. You did state that the biddings would be more beneficial for local companies than it is for overseas companies, because that's one of our biggest problems right now. Majority of the government business are taking the business overseas, buying something for a penny less, and killing us.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's a good question, and I'll show you some of the things, and Liz has talked about some of the things that are in the new law and the regulation to protect local suppliers. But your point exactly, office supplies, we made a conscious decision when we went out to bid office supplies, and we'd had a number of discussions with the suppliers, and we said, no, we're gonna put a circle around the island. If you were in possession of a trade and business license, you could bid. Didn't, couldn't bid. We have plenty of office supplies, suppliers on the island. So that's an example of where strategically, as a government, there's no point going to us. They can go make alliances and deal with the sub-suppliers off island. We don't need to get into that business. But there are many cases where we have adequate, like that slide said, adequate local capacity and capability. And we do have a number of active measures now in the new regulations, which we don't have currently. So even including criteria for local benefits. So what can you do for us? How are you going to benefit the local economy? And whether that's using labor, whether that's using suppliers, using, you know, whatever it is, we want that to be rewarded. So that was one of the things that was critical, even when we were talking Cabinet and Congress about this over the last couple of years. That was something that came up. So we hope we didn't want to go the other way, and some people just say, look, agree to pay 20% more. It's not always the right thing either. There are some industries, as you know, sometimes we just don't have the supplier base here.
Yes.
We're going to go off on it. Mm-hmm. That's okay.
And the other thing which has happened in the last number of years here, where the contract is awarded and there's promises made that they will employ local Caymanian labour, and then once the contract is signed, that promise is not upheld. That would be part of the criteria to judge them in the future, and they'd have to put that on the website.
Mm-hmm.
So if they win a bid to say, okay, we're going to get duty concessions on the materials coming in or whatever, but you have to employ 60% Caymanian labour, that will be part of the contract, and it will be part of the criteria, the judgment one, and it will be part of the transparency. That's important.
That's one of the issues now, is the public often aren't aware of what those commitments were, under some of these negotiated arrangements you hear about, you hear this and that, but I think it sort of empowers the public if you can actually go and say, well, they said they were going to do this, this, and this, and this, and I have cause and reason to believe that they haven't fulfilled their commitments. So it's a lot easier for all of us to manage this if we're managing in the full light of all the facts. So it's about public right to know, the public being a good monitor, as Peter said, the better, the best auditors may be all of us. It's about transparency, it's about openness for government. Tim, I'll go back to you in a second.
Yeah,
I think there was a question in the room.
Well, I was just going to ask, in terms of the new procurement procedures, if the government is now driving more from essential purchasing, as you mentioned earlier, looking at the office supplies, looking at the entire government offices and purchasing, following suit in all sphere in terms of driving the market that direction, so you get a 2-year contract or 1 year depending on the product. So you're pushing now for that volume pricing.
Yes, that's certainly
better value for money, basically.
So is whose responsibility? Will it be the procurement then, in terms of looking at the global picture, your government?
That's our role, through my office. And so we do actually, when I first got here, true story, I had noted one of the former auditors, the Auditor General's office, had made a claim, one of the reports saying that nobody had any data as to what's actually being spent. So I took that as a bit of a personal challenge. So one of the first things I did, I got here in February, and by August of 2015, I actually had all of the data from every single ministry. Took it, cleansed the data. I know how many transactions we have when we're talking about how many of those small dollar transactions. But that was first time we actually had a complete view of everything. And I didn't want to see the details of names and that, but I wanted to get a sense of how we were distributing the spend across. We have 14 ministries, 26 statutory authorities. So it's a lot of spend. But that was the first time we actually had a good sense of where things were. And back to your point, this is where we start to see potential targets for taking this and aggregating it. So ministry is doing it, ministry A is doing it, ministry B and ministry D is all doing the same thing. One was January, one was March, one was December.
Services, they're all being individually negotiated contracts for particular departments.
So yeah, it's a big job, but certainly we've started down that road. But I can't promise you it's going to be fixed by next year. But certainly we've made progress that way. Sorry, back to you, Tim.
Great. I'm intrigued. You know, the four headed job. That one on procurement notices and bidding opportunities, I find it pretty exciting. Tell me if I'm reading this right. So
are you giving me a law ball?
Yeah, let's do that because I can't wait to see that. Because here's the thing, if you have a way that this website can be in push mode, right?
Yes.
In other words, I've got two questions, and then if you could get them answered as you go through this, because we're the Chamber of Commerce, great time to get this answered with all the suppliers here.
Yeah.
Two questions. One is, are they going to be able to sign up where they get push notification of when a new bid's been uploaded?
Yeah.
But here's the second thing. I know I'm a hippie for saying this, but you know one of the problems we run, because I'm you know, running an interesting thing. It's a company in a very competitive industry, and we operate in a very competitive space. It is run like a business, right? But it's owned by the government, so we have to follow all these guidelines.
Yeah.
All of them. And here's one of the problems. When we go to bid, it tends to be a couple of things happen. One is that you get a fairly narrow pool that you're fishing in, right? But then the second thing is folks just say you're fed up with bidding on your request for quotes. Because they haven't won a bid yet, and they've done all this work to bid, and so on. And I'm wondering, how do you counter that? I guess it's called bid exhaustion or whatever, you know, because you keep going back, and there's one little job that you got to do, and you need a contractor to build something. And then there's a repair job in another building, or, you know.
Yeah.
And every time we ask them for a bid, because it's a substantial amount of money involved, right? And then eventually, some of them just get fed up, and it's kind of scary because they get up with one bidder and you know what happens then, right? So anyhow, those two things, if you can answer those, you work your way through it.
Yeah.
How did we know all the outlines?
I'll show you the procurement notices because this one I think is the one of the main things for you guys to see. But yes, they can sign up for notifications.
Yeah.
The second part is much harder. And it's one of the things I've been talking about internally since I got here. It's about making the government a customer of choice rather than being a bit of a burden, which, you know, I hear the stories and I've heard some of the things that have gone on, and we can do a lot to improve our game in terms of not being a burden on suppliers. You know, they give you the quote and then they don't hear anything and then you disappear, and then 6 months later they come back and say, can you quote the same thing again? I'm sure these things are no surprise to anyone, right? Part of what we have to do internally is teach our people that vendor relations are important. We have to do this in a proper way. We don't want to be wasting your time. We don't want to be making you go through extra hoops. We'll talk about what's on the
side. And vendor qualifications are important, because
asking for the same information 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 times a year, does that happen? I suspect so. I can't promise you we're fixing all of those things tomorrow, but we do have the beginning of it.
But will this also have in there the vendor qualification?
Yeah.
Many things are asked for, like, you know, medical insurance, pension, up to date, this kind of thing.
Yeah.
If no one's been here yet, our public purchasing portal. Some of you, I'm sure, have been on here. And this is the notice board. These are tenders and RFPs that are out right now. Just to navigate where we were, I just want to see how we got there. So this is our lovely website, procure.gov.ky, www out the front. Go to procurement notices, bidding opportunities. So as of May 1st, this is where your advert goes. By law, over 100,000, the advert has to be here. No longer does it have to be in the, it can be in the local paper, but it has to be here. We have 500, 600, 700 different suppliers registered already. If you haven't been here as a supplier, go there as soon as you can. Click register. I want to know who you are and phone numbers. The first step towards this pre-qualification thing is there'll be a field for your trade and business license. Mm-hmm. Baby steps, but we're getting there. You can also select categories that you want to be notified on.
On the trade and business license, every year you renew, it's a different number, so do you have to keep updating that number?
Yeah, okay. So you're going to self-register, so you're going to go on there and you're going to put your information in. Eventually, we're going to get to the point where we want you to upload those
documents. Okay.
But you would have to refresh that every time you get a new insurance policy or every time you get a new whatever, you have to do that. But this platform has that capability. So we're still only using about probably 25% of its capabilities, but we're getting there. But for the first time, you can register, you can choose your categories. Now we're teaching our people internally is to tag the opportunity then with the appropriate code so that then you get that notification. So if they don't tag it, you don't get the notification, unfortunately. So when you go in to register, you're going to say, I'm interested in this one. There's a tag associated with that category.
Oh.
So when they go to issue the bid document, they've got to say it's for that category.
But a supplier can have more than one tag?
Yeah, oh yeah, you can check.
Right.
200 of them, if you want. It uses the standard categorization. So this is the platform. You can see here, these are open public opportunities. If I say, there's only 2 days left on that one, it might not be enough, but here's one. 31 days. You want to know some more about it? Here's your advert. You can see the calendar. It was issued March 28th. It's going to close on May 4th. You've got 31 days left. What's it all about? You can read the little blurb. This one's cybersecurity. I don't know if any of you folks are in that business, but if you are, look right here. You can see here's a code. There's a commodity code. Security and protection software. So if you had registered and said, I'm in that category, this would have blasted out an email to your inbox and said, go here. And it'll actually give you the link so you don't have to go searching for it. You just hit the button, it'll take you right to the front door of your. The documents are here. So if I was signed in as a supplier, here where it says actions, there would be a button that says download. You just click the download button. You can see there's the RFP document and there's a couple of other extra appendices. And then we tell you a little bit about how we want you to bid to us. So this one's a little bit more complicated. Getting you to bid on three different types of things within one process. But the instructions would all be here. The other interesting thing is if you're a supplier and you got a question, you don't even have to pick up the phone anymore. If we're signed in here, you could actually type your question in. Whoever on the other side is assigned to this, they get an email that says you got a question. You can choose to respond there, or they may say, you know what, we have to respond to everyone and it becomes an addendum and it goes under public notices. So you could ask a question here, but it may end up as a public notice. Made a mistake in operational today. We've been using the system now for about 2 years. So back to what we were talking about earlier about reporting. So you'll be able to come back here in a few weeks' time, so 31 days' time. This last one here will no longer be visible as an open opportunity, and it'll carry forward over to past opportunities. And these are all of the ones that have been done through using the platform to date. Oh, look at that. There's a lot still closed but not awarded, but this is what we want to see. It's awarded. Now you're curious who got it, how much.
Mm-hmm.
You click on the view opportunity and it'll actually tell you the details. So now a lot of, because it hasn't been required up until May 1st, it's required. So
mm-hmm.
some of these you might see it there, sometimes you might not see it there. But certainly going forward, the goal is to get everyone on here. So that's the, if you're a supplier to government, we want you to bid. Even when we mess up and we irritate you and we're not always the best customer, but I can tell you from a strategic standpoint, we need suppliers and we need good suppliers. We've done, I'll even talk about our reverse auction, how important local suppliers are to us. We've done 8 reverse auctions to date. Local suppliers have won every single one of them. Wasn't set up that way. Local suppliers can and are doing very well. Our goal is to make sure we support that. So it's certainly the folks that have interacted with us in some of those more complex ones have done quite well. So that's just one little place on this lovely new website. We hope you like it. We set out to make a website that doesn't look like a government website. And I'll challenge you to find one as good as this. Liz and I have looked at literally hundreds and thousands of websites all over the world. We've stolen ideas from all over the place. And, working with our friends at NetClues, they built this lovely piece for us. It's colorful. It's got motion.
Yeah, they've got a chat. We're on the home page. There's no better one than that.
We even have Mr. Peter right there.
Yeah, there you go. He's a star now.
And a little bit about the Central Procurement Office. And down here, we have some really cool stuff. We've talked about reverse auctions. If you want to learn a bit more about our reverse auction program, see how that moves. We'll love that. I can tell I'm easily bored by the government website that doesn't change, but savings initiatives. So here we'll tell you a little bit about our reverse auction program. Total savings to date is 4 million CI and climbing. We just did one a few weeks ago with the Ministry of Education, their second time around. That was an interesting one. You think the first time around you might do okay, or maybe not so good the second time around. They did ICT equipment for the public schools, and it's all big savings the second time around. Almost as good as the first one.
Was it 31%?
Yeah. Yeah, I think it was over 30% the first time. Yes, this one was like 27-28% of savings. All local suppliers.
So if they save $1 million, that means they have $1 million more to spend, or?
No.
I won't comment, though. And for those of you who can't get enough of procurement legislation, if you want to read the law and the regulations, they're here. We've got anything to do with procurement is here, so health insurance laws. This is more for civil servants. We're always looking for the right piece of legislation, but we've got it all there.
Mm-hmm.
Just touch on a couple of some of these. We wanted one website, so everything here is open to everyone. So our thought was, we're not going to segregate the public from the civil servants. If we're, we can see it, you can all see it. So we show our awards and all. So some of the stuff in here won't interest you that much. I do want to take you back down here. Liz talked about procurement plans. So one of the things we want, and we're still working on a few things, coming soon. So the idea is, now the budget's approved, we've got 2018 and 2019 budget, wouldn't that be a lovely idea to tell you folks what we've got planned? It's in the budget document. If you've seen the budget document, if you want to go look for the stuff we're going to buy, it's buried in the 1,000 pages somewhere. So we're working with some different groups, and we're actually going to publish that. And we're going to tell you we're buying 6 trucks in this ministry and order 3. Trucks in this ministry and order 2. A little bit of strategy there as well, right? As you can see where my brain goes, is why couldn't we get together on that? But what we want the suppliers to see is what's coming up. So you can start to plan your year out, and maybe the next year. So that's going to be on here. We've got our savings, we've got some project management stuff for our folks. Isn't that ethics. Oh yeah, I got to show you the code of conduct we talked about. Sorry. Missed that one. So we have created, so if you go under the ethics page, there is a draft code of conduct. And you can see we try and make it easy for you. So when it says it's attached here, click it. There you go. 7 pages. We tried to make this a little bit more readable than typical government stuff. You can see, thanks to our friends in GIS, they've got some nice brand and coloring for us. But this is really the code of conduct. So what we want all of you folks and anybody watching is read it, give us some feedback. Tell us whether we're hitting the right note. The new law required that we produce a code of conduct. Ultimately, there will be a code of conduct. This is our opportunity to get some more feedback from you folks. And we say we do want your feedback. So feedback on the draft code is welcome and can be submitted. We have an email address, or you can just click here and do one of those. You've all seen those pages. You can get them to us either way. As I told the group this morning, we actually do get our emails. We actually do read them. When it's a team of 2, we can't hide. For you as a local supplier as well, again, I didn't want to make you read the boring law and regulations, but here it explains what's going to happen and the things that we've designed for local suppliers, and some of the things we talked about on the slides, keeping you informed, avoiding restrictive specifications, having pre-bid briefings. We can call you in and talk about what we're going to do. Sometimes one of the things we've had this ongoing discussion within government of, sometimes our people are so beat up by the auditors, they're scared to talk to suppliers. And that's the worst thing we can do, is to go inward and not talk. So what we're encouraging people is say, look, it's okay to talk to suppliers. When we talk to suppliers as a group, we can have conversations, we can have private conversations. It's okay to talk to suppliers up until the point we drop the tender on the street. Then the curtain comes down, and then you can ask questions, and we'll do the back and forth. Once we've made a decision, curtain comes up, and we talk. So that's really the public procurement process shouldn't be a one-sided conversation. It needs to be. We need to hear back from you whether we're doing good, whether we're doing bad. There's some things in there. Liz in her slides talked about local industry impact statements, participation plans, and some of these things, but there's actually, if you're interested to see what it'll actually look like, I actually have it built here. So what you'll see in the future is tenders and RFPs where we'll ask you as a supplier to tell us what you're going to do for the local economy and what you're doing today. You just need to tell us. And we'll have criteria, and we'll have points assigned for that. And we'll score you. And as Peter said, then if you're selected and you've made a promise, we're going to publish that. So we want people to live up to their commitments. It's just part of business. But this is the kind of thing you would see in the bid document. So you might have to tell us a little bit more. And you know, you might say, well, you already know all of these things, but honestly, we need to have it captured. Sell yourself back to us, and we'll give you credit for that. So those are just some of the things.
We'll talk about the online bidding tools.
Yeah.
I know we're sort of rushed for time, but so.
Yeah, absolutely. We can do that. We can go back to that. So you'll hear us refer to Bonfire. If you've used the system in the last couple of years, this is the Bonfire platform. Just the name of the software is a third party piece of software that you're licensed to my office. Ultimately, you would come in here, so you'd decide whether you're going to bid, and find a simple one here. I'm just going to show you. So what you want to watch for on this platform in the future is, in the old days, we would ask you to fill out a tender document or give us a proposal, and we never really gave you many instructions. Now, what we tell you is how we want to see that information coming in. So here we actually, you can see there's actually going to be a questionnaire. It's going to be submitted in Excel. There's one required. And all of these pieces, these are all, just think of, you know, the typical proposal, and we've just blown it apart. It's like a hierarchy. So you'll see that quite often. But one of the things we were committed to, and certainly back to the point you raised with Tim, is trying to avoid asking for the same information over and over and over. What we want to get to at some point is, if you've got your trade and business license, we don't ask you for the copy, but we've got it already. We don't ask you for your up-to-date insurance, because we've got it already. Compliance, some of them, because things change, but there's some standard documentation that we'll be able to pull from your file that you will upload it. But ultimately, you will submit here electronically, so you'll just upload your documents right on this platform. Has anyone here used Bonfire? Yeah, used it. It's pretty intuitive. The reason we chose this particular platform is it's like Amazon. It's about drop downs and it's very intuitive. Like, there's really no training that's needed. I mean, how many people go on to Amazon.com and do their shopping and choose your item, put it in a checkout, and off you go? Well, this is built on the same kind of a platform. So we chose it because it is simple. It is easy, but it does great things. So.
And it has the opportunity, why I was involved in it, was involved in one, it's a selection for some of the contracts. One of several people have to assess them.
Yeah.
So it has a great assessment tool, so I guess that's how you do it.
That's how we get it.
It's fantastic. That's
so the Bonfire system does a number of things. One is, it can be just an advert. So you'll put your advert on there, but you could decide, like these folks did, they're going to receive the bids electronically. But that's the choice of the ministry or the SAGC. And then they can decide, do you want to evaluate electronically? So Will's talking about, he was an evaluator on a project where we put the advert out, the documents electronically, and then it allows us to then do literally a virtual evaluation, so we don't need Will and 10 other people in a room sitting around flipping pages. You can stay here, you can stay there, you can stay there, you go into the platform and you actually do your reading, your scoring, your evaluation all online. We typically bring them together maybe, you know, towards the end just to, as a bit of a sanity check, just to make sure things, you know, things are as they should be, but it does give civil servants and certainly anyone who's an evaluator a real benefit that way. And Liz mentioned, as of, I'm going to show you that slide, because that's the sustainability paper. So this is a byproduct of, we have a page devoted to sustainability issues. We're trying to get people to think about procurement in terms of what the impact is on the environment. But here's a lovely picture. Thanks again to the guys at NetClues. See down here, this was as of last October, 230,000 pages of paper avoided through using the bonfire system. What that looked like, so we talked about it. So we just want to see the boxes piled up. So this is just an image to give you some thought, but that's with bonfire being used on a voluntary basis. So now March 1st or May 1st, everyone's got to use bonfire. Let's talk about what that number looks like a year from now. Get a million pages of paper. Do the math. $30 a case. And that's just a residual savings. Like, we never set out to do it for that reason, but it's a nice bonus. And it not only saves you guys having to print, you know, and ship, courier, or however you want to get it to us. Gives you more time to work on your submissions. And when we say give us the bids electronically, you got to stop a few days before, you got to go get it printed, you got to get it bound, you got to hand it over to the courier or give it to the junior office clerk to say get it there, and somebody gets into an accident or gets lost or the courier doesn't lose the package. So those are some of the, you know, the nice side effects from using an electronic system. The system is completely secure. We're using the platform, actually, Bonfire is built on Amazon Web Services. So if this system goes down, you're not shopping on Amazon.com either. You're going to lose all of your internet things. So we've had an audit at our computer services department. They have top-notch security as well. So. Any other questions? I could go on for hours, but I don't want to keep you here past supper time. Hopefully that gives you a good sense of some of the things, but my parting thought will be procure.gov.ky. I'm going to get little stickers and hand out at some time.
Put your hands together.
You guys are a great audience. Lots of great questions.
And like I said, we'll be posting this video online as well. We're going to share with our membership. Thank you for attending, and good luck in securing government contracts.